Hey, Arts people. Someone sent me a cool little picture that someone posted on Facebook, so I want to discuss it and talk about horse thermal regulation, winter, hot, cold. I'll put a link to where I cover this on the website. A lot of the documents that I show here, I'll have links to them in the description and on my website. And let's get started. So this is like for a horse trying to maintain his body temperature. Thermal regulation is basically temperature control. So when you talk about thermal regulation, it's basically you're regulating the temperature. So a horse regulates his temperature through different ways, through sweating, evaporation. But evaporation of sweat doesn't happen when it's really humid out. Because sweating happens, it removes heat. It assists in heat. And so when horses sweat over their body, they're the only other animal besides humans that sweat over their whole body. When they sweat and release that heat, as the wind removes that heat and cools the body, it helps removing heat. But when a horse is sweaty and you're in a thick, humid climate, the water doesn't evaporate. So it ends up increasing the heat, which is why when a horse is sweating a lot, sometimes if you rake them, use a sweat scraper on them and remove the sweat, it helps cool them better. Remember, when they're sweating, they're losing water, which can put them into other issues. Compaction, they don't have enough water, they get blocked up. So, you know, there's a lot of things on a horse cools and heats up. But in the winter, a lot of people don't mention it, but I think it's extremely overlooked, is the access to water. Too many people in the winter let their water freeze and says, the horse will get a drink when it melts. When you're cold, you don't want to drink ice water. When you're thirsty, if your horse is healthy, it's better when they can drink water when they want and not have to wait until the water thaws out. And when the water freezes, and they're eating or you're feeding them hay, thinking you're keeping them warm, they're using up a lot more moisture to dissolve and work the hay, which gives them heat, which is good. But if they can't get fresh water, then you can cause impaction colic. So all kind of issues. But let's take a look at these thermal pictures. So here is a couple pictures that someone took of their horses before feeding and after feeding, which is really interesting. Because a horse stays warm by eating and keeping his digestive system going, and then he produces heat. So if you notice, the red is heat and the blue is cold. The horse's back, which is normally where the snow sets and the wind hits, they'll usually stand with their butt. So a lot of times their butt is also, you know, I'm surprised it's not bluer, but they're probably not standing in the wind here in this picture. So anyway, this is before feeding. You notice there's a lot more blue area, maybe under the belly and over the back and almost downside the rib cage. This is also known as the drip line. When it rains, a lot of the water goes right here and then it drips down. So you'll notice that there's some good heat here, but there's some cold spots. This picture over here on the right is after, 20 minutes after she fed. And you'll notice the blue is going away because the body is producing more heat. Now, this picture is closer and this picture is farther. I would rather them be at the same distance because you can still see a little blue here. And I don't want somebody thinking that the pictures are doctored and this is, which it could be. Like I said, I wish they were both the same to really get it. But you can tell, especially right here, where the blue is on the left by the flank right here, it's really heating up because the hay is going to the belly and intestines and it's producing heat and it's starting that chemical reaction, which is why horses need to eat. This feeding two times a day is just really bad for a horse. It causes all kind of problems. So this picture is from Renee Capps, and I don't know where she posted it or who she sent it to or who sent it to me. Sorry if no one finds this interesting except me. I find it interesting. Rome lives outside and has a covered shelter, but doesn't live in insulated barns with heavy blankets in a place with shavings like the other three do. Okay, so insulated barns, heavy blankets. I am not a fan of blankets because they tend to trick and mess up. It's no different than shaving a horse. You mess up the horse's natural ability. So I get that there are some situations when a blanket may be needed. When I transported my horses and it was freaking, you know, 0 degrees and I'm riding a horse trailer, I put a blanket on my horses. It was an open trailer. There was a lot of breeze and they were standing around. They couldn't walk and they couldn't eat. They were trapped in a trailer. So I had a blanket on them. So there's situations where a blanket can assist, but ideally when a horse is free to move, free to eat, free to drink, and free to find shelter from the wind and rain, the horse does better. All right. Even though he is a woolly mammoth and clearly absolutely no danger of starvation, because she's trying to say he's fed well. And again, I don't think the horse looks skinny at all. This really shows how they stay warm. The first photo on the right is when I fed this morning. You can see along the top line, it's not as warm as the rest of the body. She said the right. I'm looking at it on the left. This morning, you can see the top line is not as warm as the rest of the body. Then on the next photo, where he's completely warm everywhere, which was about 20 minutes after he had been eating, it was cool to see that he started eating and it really did generate a ton of body heat. So she said, right, this is my left over here. This is the right. This is after he ate. This is before he ate. Okay. More blue, more cold, more dark colors, not so much red over here. You got a little bit more orange and red and different bright colors. So in this little article I found, it's from a bunch of veterinarians. I'm not sure. What's the website? ScienceDirect.com. They're talking about chilly rain, combined wind, cirrus. Wind and rain and low temperatures are really tough on a horse. Clipping and the use of rugs, which is a blanket, interferes with natural thermoregulation mechanics or mechanisms. Horses should be given freedom of choice to cope with varying weather. Freedom meaning the ability to walk and exercise, the ability to eat when they want, the ability to get out of the wind and to get out of the rain. That's what freedom of choice means. So this is a article that she wrote, or they wrote, whatever. It's going through here. I'll put a link in the description. This article sounds good, but it's above my head and it's not for the layman. Maybe everyone else understands it. I'm the only dummy that doesn't. Horses respond to chronic cold exposure by acclimatizing adult horses. Clinical temperature, LTC, and 15 degrees Celsius. Yearling horses have LTC of minus 11 Celsius. If fed ab lib of zero, limit energy moderate. Newborns have LTC of 20. Horses, unlike cattle, do not respond to chronic cold exposure, increasing thyroid hormone secretion. Thyroid hormone secretion responds more to the lengthy photo period. Whatever. Okay. I'm pretty sure what this means is if horses have fresh water that they can drink, not frozen water with ice that people go out there and go, man, I went and broke the ice up from a horse to drink. Wow. Wow. You're a good owner. Maybe if you ever come back as a horse, you can get an owner like you that just goes out and breaks the ice up like you're doing a horse a favor. Anyway, fresh water that they can drink. Ability to move and graze and eat, free access so they can nibble, not throwing them a flake of hay and making them eat at one time and then 12 hours later coming out and throwing them another flake of hay when it's convenient and then they have to gorge and eat that very quickly. All bad. I'm pretty sure that's what all this means. And this little PDF, which I'll put a link to, really kind of goes over about thermoregulation for horses in heat. And a couple things that I liked about this is there's a lot of horse people out there that always tell you, don't let your horse drink after you exercise. It's not good for him. I never got that. When I'm thirsty after I run, I want a glass of water. I want to get some fluids back in my system so it can slowly start, working its way through my whole body to my organs and everything so I can get some fluids in me. I don't run and go exercise. And then when I'm really thirsty, withhold water from me just because there's a bunch of barn witches saying that you should withhold water. So in here, I think whoever did this article covers that withholding water is not good. Let's see, radiant heat loss, convection heat loss. That goes through the different ways that horses get heat and do heat. I've seen a lot of people run their horse till they get sweaty like this. If you're working a horse this sweaty, man, you're really stressing a horse in a lot of ways. All kind of things. And horses that I see sweating like this normally have diarrhea because they're losing weight and they're stressed too much. I mean, I don't mind working a horse or using a horse, but just to freaking make it get this lathery and sweaty is not good for human or horse. I mean, you could just overdo it. Talks about electrolytes. It's got some links in it. Myth busting. Pouring cold water on a horse can cause them to colic or tie up. Tying up isn't the application of cold water. It happens inside the muscles as a result of dehydration and accumulation of lactic acid. Dehydration also causes impaction colic. So this is when people withhold water. I don't get it. And I've always heard you don't hose off a horse because you'll cause them to tie up. Now, and I'm not sure about shocking a horse and dropping his temperature very quickly. I mean, I don't want to. Sometimes when I was younger, I used to like to jump in cold water if I was really hot and sweaty, and it would still shock me, and I'd jump out, but it would cool me down really quick. And some people say that's good for the system; it helps build your immune system. But I've always heard the same thing from people telling me, "Don't hose your horse off when he's hot because you drop his temperature too quick." Oh, you know, moderation. I mean, don't go crazy and shock it too much. Let's see here. I can only give my horses 7 sips of water, right? There's a theory out there about only let your horse sip water with take away his water. Look, when a horse is hot and sweaty, it's usually good to walk them out. That prevents, just like after people run a long way or if you sprint, you shouldn't stop or sit down. Your muscles will tighten up, you will cramp up. Horses do the same thing. If you run the crap out of a horse and then go tie him up and then you walk off and get blood flow back into your butt and legs because you've been sitting on a horse running, and then you make your horse stand there tied. Walking a horse is the best way to cool a horse down and get his muscles to where they slow down, his heart rate slows down, sweating starts, etc. You know, when I was younger and we used to rent horses and we'd run the shit out and we'd bring them back. And the policy was, you bring a horse back sweaty, you walk him till he's dry. And that's a good way to teach a young kid, hey, don't get a horse so damn sweaty, or you're gonna get off and you're gonna walk him until he dries off. And that may take a while, but it's really good for the horse if he naturally dries and he's walking calmly and his body gets to you know, go back down. So anyway, I thought it was a great picture. I'm glad it was a post. Whoever shared it for me, thanks. And I'll put links in all the stuff. Y'all have a good one. Buddy, Miss T, you're good boys. Ransom too.